Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Nevertheless, thy will be done. That's a beautifully awful prayer. Nevertheless, thy will be done is the most freeing, enslaving, constricting, liberating prayer we can pray. Nevertheless, thy will be done brings both anxiety and peace. On the one hand, it's incredibly freeing to be released from the burden of having to be in charge of the whole world. On the other hand, it's kind of terrifying to realize that you're not the one in charge of the whole world. Nevertheless, thy will be done. That prayer depends on the one to whom you pray. Because what if you're Rapunzel stuck in her tower? You saw the movie, right? Tangled, Disney 2010, you know the movie? The princess Rapunzel is stolen as an infant by the evil Gothel, and she's imprisoned in a tall tower. As the little baby grows up into a young woman, this wicked Gothel claims to be Rapunzel's mother. She lies to her. She pretends like she's protecting her and providing for her, but the reality is Gothel is keeping Rapunzel locked up in a tower for her own selfish purposes. Poor Rapunzel doesn't know any better. She's been duped, kept in the dark. And when Rapunzel does finally ask about leaving her tower, she gets a lesson from her mother. And because it's Disney, it comes in the form of a song, right? If you know the song, if you've seen the movie, you're probably singing along in your head right now. Trust me, my pet, mother knows best. You know the song? Mother knows best. Listen to your mother. It's a scary world out there. You see, Gothel is manipulating Rapunzel's fear. She's making her fear seem out of proportion so she can keep her under her thumb, keep control of her. Mother knows best. One way or another, something will go wrong, I swear. Ruffians, thugs, poison ivy, quicksand, cannibals, snakes, the plague. Mother's right here. Mother will protect you. Darling, here's what I suggest. Skip the drama. Stay with Mama. Mama knows best. It's actually pretty catchy. It's got a nice tune to it. And quite honestly, it really gets stuck in your ear. So I've ruined the afternoon for most of you here today. And in principle, the idea should be right. I mean, it's a good thing when kids can trust their mother, when their parent is reliable. I want my kids to trust their mom, their dad. It's a good thing, but not in this case. You see, Gothel is not trustworthy. Gothel is selfish. She's deceptive. Gothel's desire, her purpose, her plan, Gothel's will is not for Rapunzel's good. And Rapunzel has no way of knowing that. The song takes, for me, an even more chilling turn as it ends. Gothel begins the song by manipulating Rapunzel's fear, but she ends the song by manipulating with imaginary love. And I'm not going to sing it, so we brought along a video clip. It's just creepy, isn't it? Her hair, the long hair, that's part of the story. The hair is what Gothel really covered. She doesn't care about Rapunzel. You can see her touching the hair and kissing the hair and playing with the hair. She doesn't really care about Rapunzel at all. Oh, that song drives me crazy because I would say those kinds of things to my kids. So to see them manipulated like that, that's just, oh, that's awful. It's a betrayal of fundamental humanity. I want to rescue Rapunzel from her tower. I want to grab the naive girl and wake her up. I want to see Gothel be done away with. And it strikes me that that feeling of repulsion, that desire to rescue someone who's a little too naive, that impulse to swoop in and save is actually what some people experience when they see God and religion I read this anonymous quote online a couple of days ago. Religion is regarded by the common people as true, by the wise as false, and by rulers as useful. Reminds me of Karl Marx. Religion is the opiate of the people. To that way of thinking, God and religion, that's simply the strong deceiving the weak to keep them in control. It's Gothel and Rapunzel all over again. Those in power stay in power by manipulating fear and faking love. So just like I want to see Rapunzel rescued from the evil Gothel who manipulates her and keeps her under her thumb, the atheist who sees religion as naive people being duped will sometimes have that impulse to sweep in and rescue, to set them free. I think that's why someone like Penn Jillette, you know, Penn Jillette from Penn and Teller, I think that's what's behind Penn Jillette saying something like, "Love and respect all people, hate and destroy all faith." I don't think Penn's evil. He wants you to love and respect all people. I do think Penn's afraid that weak people are being manipulated and controlled by religion. So he can say, hate and destroy all faith. Now, because you're all here this morning, I kind of assume that the basic premise of these atheistic quotes is something you reject, but the problem is people in power do sometimes use God or religion or even the name of Jesus to stay in power, to manipulate fear, to feign love. The man who quotes scripture as grounds for mistreating his wife, the cleric who promotes violence and fear against the other or foreigner and calls it religion, the mother who manipulates her kids with threats of an angry and judgmental God. The naive can be held under someone's thumb. Faith sometimes is used as a weapon. To our deep grief, religion can be warped to legitimate evil people doing evil things. And when we start to see God as if he were Gothel, then it makes perfect sense to say with the atheist Richard Dawkins, faith can be very dangerous, and deliberately to implant it into the vulnerable mind of an innocent child is a grievous wrong. If God is like Gothel, then Dawkins is right. Then what are you doing bringing your kids and grandkids to worship? Why would you ever read Bible or pray with those poor, innocent, naive children? You're infecting their minds with a disease. If God is like Gothel, then God can't be trusted. If God is like Gothel, you've got no God worth praying to at all. And then Dawkins and the rest of the atheists would have been right all along. So when we look at Jesus' prayer in the garden, when we look at a prayer that says, "Nevertheless, not what I will, but what you will," we have to recognize coming out of the gate that that's a scary prayer. That's a dangerous prayer. And depending on the person to whom you pray that prayer, it could go very poorly for you or for me. It depends on the person to whom we pray. But even when we do take that step and to say to anyone in our lives, "Not my will, but your will," what we come to find is it's more about a relationship. It's more about trusting the person than it is about knowing the details of the plan. I know that's true. If you've ever been a parent or had a parent, then somewhere in your life you've experienced a time when the kid didn't know the whole thing, the whole picture, didn't know the whole story, didn't know everything that was going on, and at some point mom or dad had to say, "I got this, trust me, I know what's going on, and please just listen to me." And that's a moment some of us said, "Okay," and trusted, and some of us said, "No, you're crazy, I won't." But that's a moment where you're being invited into relationship, being asked on faith to understand that there's a bigger picture than you see at the moment. It might look like this. You probably experienced something like this. You can hear a couple of your kids kind of arguing in the other room, and by the time you decide you better get up from your coffee and go and see what's going on, the toy's already broken, both kids are in tears, both of them have kind of red puffy faces, and they're both pointing the finger of blame at the other. Has that ever happened to you? I mean, it's never happened in my house. but I know that theoretically it could happen. And because you're a good parent, you separate the kids, you listen to both sides of the story, and they both sound eerily similar. It was their fault. They did it. They deserve punishment. And they're probably even willing to give you a list of things you could do to punish the other child. And so you say to this purely innocent child who did nothing wrong in the situation and is completely offended, you say to them, okay, I'll take care of it. And then the debate begins. So what are you going to do? Don't worry, I'll take care of it. Are you going to send him to the room? I'll take care of it. Are you going to ground him? I'll take care of it. Are they going to get a spanking? I'm going to take care of it. Thank you for your input. And at that point, you don't have to get your child on board with your whole agenda. You don't have to get them to sign off on every detail of your plan. You don't have to show them the book and the appendix of the book on parenting that you have on your shelf. You don't have to come up with the 10-year child-rearing guide and give them a lesson on interpersonal dynamics at that point. At that point, you need them to trust you as a parent, to be true to your word, that there's more going on than they see, and even though it seems unfair, you've got their good in mind. Now, as parents, we don't do that perfectly. But what if that experience was something we took to how we view God? I know I can certainly be like that kid with the broken toy, right? I see something, it goes wrong, it certainly wasn't my fault, it was the other person's fault, I'm completely not to blame, and I expect God to step in and make it right. I want him to act kind of on my timetable, and I've got a short list of things that he could do to the other person to make it all better. Certainly there are times in my life when I don't see the big picture, don't know everything that's going on. And to hear my Heavenly Father say, hey, trust me, I got this. At that point, he's inviting me in to a moment of faith. He's giving me a chance to put his will above my will. If God is a loving parent who can be trusted, then maybe I don't have to demand my laundry list gets accomplished. Maybe trust isn't so naive if it's placed in a trustworthy person. If God knows me and loves me and knows the whole story in a way I can't, maybe I don't have to get all the details to know that he'll take care of it. Now, those are two very different ways of viewing God and what he's up to, of viewing God's will and the invitation to pray, nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. God could be like Gothel, feigning love and manipulating fear, or God could be like the loving parent who has a big picture in a way we can't, who says to you, trust me, I love you, and I'm going to take care of this. So it's possible that God could actually be like Rapunzel's captor. It's possible that our prayers fall on deaf ears. We know selfish people who pretend to speak for God can do all kinds of wrong, and yet it's also possible. It also seems to fit the story. If God were a loving God, whose will is good and perfect and right, even when we don't understand it, and if that's the kind of God we have, then he deserves all the naive trust you and I can muster. So how do you decide? How do you decide which way you're going to view God at any given moment? Well, there's a couple options. You can look at people you know and respect. You can look at religious folk, people that you know and trust, clergy, church workers, people on the TV, and you can see what they say about God and how they treat him. But there's also other people that you seem to like and seem to have a megaphone, people like Penn Jillette, who's a really cool guy, and he can do some neat magic tricks, and he's got a very different view. And honestly, even the religious folk, if you hang out with them too long, you'll discover that they're stinking sinners too, that they're going to fail in their discipleship walk, that they're going to act sometimes as if God were more like Gothel, even if they're a pastor or teacher, a professional church worker. or one of your grandparents or parents or friends. They're going to let you down. So you can't rely on them to show you. I guess you could look at your own circumstances. I mean, if life's going pretty good for you, if your job's going fine, if your family's healthy, if things are pretty good, then you've got a natural tendency to say, man, God, he must be a good God and have a good plan for my life because my life is going pretty well. And the problem with that is, what if it doesn't? I mean, what if you lose that job? What if your family's health fails? What if you're in a situation right now where everything you see in front of you, your circumstance tells you God isn't good, or he doesn't love you, or both? What if your circumstance tells you something different? Then what do? You can trust your heart. And there are days when it feels to me like God is my loving Father, and I rejoice in that. And there are days when it feels to me like if there's a God, he has no idea what he's doing, because I can't tell what he's up to. So if you rely on even religious people to point you the way, or if you trust your circumstances to be an accurate guide, if you want to judge your own emotion, you're going to be left wondering, is this thing a hoax? Is this God thing real? So where do you go? To decide between God is like Gothel and I'm like Rapunzel, or God is a loving parent even when I can't see the whole picture, how do you decide which one is true? More and more over the last couple of years, I've grown aware of the fact that a follower of Jesus is defined by this simple fact: I want to be like my rabbi. If Jesus is my rabbi, my teacher, if I'm his disciple, his follower, This is what disciples of rabbis did. They wanted to be like their rabbi. They wanted to pray like their rabbi and think like their rabbi and read scripture like their rabbi and believe like their rabbi. So maybe for followers of Jesus, where we look when we come up against, is God like Gothel or is God a loving father? Maybe where we turn is Jesus, and see how he makes that decision and see how he prays. Because it strikes me that Jesus himself was betrayed by the religious leaders of his day. He couldn't count on priests and Pharisees and scribes to uphold God's law or to point him to a true relationship with Yahweh his God. They betrayed him unto his death. It strikes me that Jesus couldn't trust his external circumstances. If you look at what's going on in the Garden of Gethsemane, if you see what's right in front of them, Jesus himself said, God, this looks like hell on earth. Is there any way we can do it differently? His circumstances point Jesus away from a loving God. So how does Jesus make that decision? How does Jesus pray in the garden? It's funny, we couldn't find a Disney clip for this part. There's no catchy little song with a jingle that sticks in your ear. The clip we got here of the Garden of Gethsemane is a lot darker and more foreboding. It's not as catchy. You can't kind of sing along. In fact, it's in Aramaic. It's a scene from The Passion of the Christ. There's subtitles if you can read them. And in this movie, they kind of creatively, artistically put the same Satan who is at Jesus' temptation there in the garden, as if to say the devil himself is tempting Jesus in that moment of suffering and struggle. Satan is tempting Jesus to see God like Gothel, someone you can't trust. Let's watch that clip. Jesus himself called it anguish to the point of death in his soul. Struggling with what was going to happen next, Jesus used an image from the Old Testament, the cup of God's wrath, the judgment against all sin, the evil that you and I have done, that all people of all time have permitted to happen, the manipulation, the holding people under our thumb, the using fear as a tool and faking love for our own purposes. All of that gets put in one boiling cauldron, and the righteous judgment of God against sin is going to be poured out in Jesus, and Jesus sees that and knows that it's his to drink. And he asks the Father, Father, and he calls him Father, Abba. If there's any other way, please. And then Jesus adds the most important word, the pivotal moment of that prayer, nevertheless. Nevertheless, Jesus prays, not my will, but yours be done. I don't want it. It's too much. The suffering is too great. I don't want to see it through. Nevertheless, not what I will, what you will. If there's any other way to save these people that you love, if there's any other way to atone for sin, if animal sacrifice could somehow be enough, then please don't make me go through with this. But nevertheless, your will for salvation, for eternity, for life, let your will be done, not mine. And in that moment, in that word, nevertheless, Jesus not only prays to his Father, Jesus proclaims to you and me. When Jesus says nevertheless, he's telling you and me, you have a good Father and you can trust him. Even when it's dark and you're not sure of the path, he's still there. When Jesus prays nevertheless, he's proclaiming words that you and I can take to heart. You have a good Father and you can trust him. Even when your situation is difficult, even when you don't have the big picture, even in the face of suffering, when the religious people in your life betray you, when your circumstances look like they're all falling apart, when your heart feels empty, even then you have a God you can trust. When Jesus prays, nevertheless, he's saying to you in the quiet of your own heart, in the depth of your own pain, you have a good Father. And you can trust him. You can trust his good and gracious will, because his will, when it is done, his will brings life and a love for his children. Even when you can't see it, even when you can't feel it, even when you couldn't possibly imagine it. So Jesus prays, nevertheless. And then he takes that cup of God's wrath and he drinks it to the dregs. And with his last breath, he commits himself to the will of his Father. A last breath that's not quite so final after all, because you see, God's good and gracious will for his children, beginning with his only begotten Son, is life and love and eternity. And what began in the resurrection of Jesus continues on in your life and in mine. Already now we have part in that resurrection life according to God's will and God's purpose. And on the last day, you also shall stand upon the earth and you will see God in your own flesh, you and not another. How my heart burns within me. And until that day, we're stuck. We're stuck in a time where religious leaders still fail you. We're stuck in a time when your family and friends can point you away from Jesus as easily as they can point you towards him. We're stuck in living in an experience where we have suffering and grief and death. And as we struggle with our own darkness, as we face up to our own sin and the brokenness that we also have brought into this world, we lean into the nevertheless of Jesus' prayer. Seeing Jesus trust his Father helps us trust God as our Father too. When we see faith being manipulated, when we see fear being used in the name of religion, when we see even the name of Jesus being put up as an excuse for shameful behavior, even then we've got a place to run, a place to go when life seems out of control. We begin to echo even now the trust that Jesus showed in the nevertheless, even as he prayed in the garden. So we too echo that word, God, help me do well on this homework assignment. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. God, I need a better job. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. God, please make me more popular at school or at work. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. God, bring more people to our church. Fill up this place. We want to be a large and vibrant faith community, yet nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. God, fix what's broken in our nation. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. God, show that person their fault and their sin and their offense. Cause them to repent and apologize to me sometime soon. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. God, help us conceive a child. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. God, I want out of this marriage. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. God, take this cancer from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. Jesus points us to his good Father. A Father whose good and gracious will can be trusted even when you don't see it, even when you don't feel it. And so we also echo the words of our Savior. Nevertheless.